Hello everybody, welcome to our YouTube channel Jai Sri Jawaji. Name of the book: Boundaries, When to Say Yes, How to Say No to Take Control of Your Life. Authors: Dr. Henry Cloud and Dr. John Townsend. Part 1: What are Boundaries? Unit 8: Boundaries and Your Friends starts. Marsha switched on the television, not even noticing which show was on. She was thinking about her phone call with her best friend Tammy. She had asked Tammy to go to a movie with her. Tammy had had other plans for the evening. Once again, Marsha had taken the initiative. Once again, she was disappointed. Tammy never called her. Was this what friendship was supposed to be about? Friendship. The word conjures up images of intimacy, fondness, and a mutual drawing together of two people. Friends are symbols of how meaningful our lives have been. The saddest people on earth are those who end their days with no relationships in which they are truly known and truly loved. Friendship can be a broad category. Most of the relationships mentioned in this book have friendship components. But for our purposes, let's define friendship as a non-romantic relationship that is attachment-based rather than function-based. In other words, let's exclude relationships based on a common task like work or ministry. Let's look at friendship as comprising people we want to be around just for their own sake. Boundary conflicts with friends come in all sizes and shapes. To understand the various issues, let's look at a few conflicts and how they can be resolved with boundaries. Conflict 1. Compliant versus compliant. In some ways, it was a great friendship. In other ways, it was awful. Sean and Tim enjoyed the same sports activities and recreation. They went to the same church and liked the same restaurants, but they were just too nice to each other. They both had difficulty saying no to each other. Their realization of the problem came up one weekend when a whitewater rafting trip and a 60s concert were scheduled on the same day. Sean and Tim enjoyed both activities, but they couldn't do both. Sean called Tim, suggesting they go rafting. Absolutely, answered his friend. However, unbeknownst to each other, neither Sean nor Tim really wanted to go rafting. In their heart of hearts, both men had been looking forward to going to the concert. Halfway down the river, Sean and Tim got honest with each other. Tired and wet, Tim blurted out, "It was your big idea to come on this trip." "Tim," Sean said with surprise, "I thought you wanted to go rafting." "Oh no, since you called me, I figured that's what you wanted. Old buddy," he continued ruefully, "maybe it's time we stop treat each other like China dolls." The result of two compliants interacting is that neither does what he really wants. Each is so afraid of telling the other the truth that neither ever does. Let's apply a boundary checklist to this conflict. This checklist of questions will not only help you locate where you are in setting boundaries, but also show you how to get where you want to go. 1. What are the symptoms? One symptom of a compliant conflict is dissatisfaction, a sense that you allowed something you should not have. 2. What are the roots? Compliance come from backgrounds where they had to avoid saying no to keep others happy. Since their roots are similar, it's often hard for two compliant people to help each other. 3. What is a boundary conflict? Compliant people politely deny their own boundaries to keep the peace. 4. Who needs to take ownership? Each compliant needs to take responsibility for his or her attempts to appease or please the other. Sean and Tim both need to admit that they each control the other by being nice. 5. What do they need? Compliant people need to have supportive relationships to plug into, be they support groups, home Bible studies, or counselors. Their fear of hurting the other person makes it difficult for them to set boundaries on their own. 6. How do they begin? Both compliants practice setting limits on trivial things. They may begin with being honest about things like taste in the restaurants, church liturgies, music and the like. 7. How do they set boundaries with each other? Sean and Tim talk with each other face to face, finally telling the truth and revealing limits they would like to start setting. They commit themselves to better boundaries with each other. 8. What happens next? Sean and Tim may have to admit that their interests are not as similar as they had thought. They may need to separate more from each other. Having different friends for different activities is no blot on the relationship. It might help their friendship in the long run. Conflict 2. Compliant versus aggressive controller. The compliant-aggressive controller conflict, the most identifiable of friendship conflicts, has classic symptoms. The compliant feels intimidated and inferior in the relationship. The aggressive controller feels irritated at being nagged by the compliant. "Well, all right, if you insist," is a catchphrase of the compliant. Usually, the aggressive controller is insisting on using some of the compliant's time, talents, or treasures. The aggressive controller has no problem demanding what she wants. Sometimes, she just takes what she wants without asking. "I needed it," is enough reason for the aggressive controller to help herself to whatever the compliant has, be it car keys, a cup of sugar, or 3 hours of time. Since the compliant is usually unhappy in this relationship, he is the one who needs to take action. Let's put this relationship through the boundary checklist. 1. What are the symptoms? The compliant feels controlled and resentful. The aggressive controller feels good, except she doesn't like to be nagged. 2. What are the roots? The compliant probably grew up in a family who taught him to avoid conflict rather than embrace it. The aggressive controller never received training in delaying gratification and in taking responsibility for herself. 3. What is a boundary conflict? Two specific boundary conflicts are the inability of the compliant to set clear limits with his friend and the inability of the aggressive controller to respect the compliant's limits. 4. Who needs to take ownership? The compliant needs to see that he isn't a victim of the aggressive controller. He is volunteering his power to his friend on a silver platter. Giving up his power is his way of controlling his friend. The compliant controls the aggressive controller by pleasing her, hoping it will appease her and cause her to change her behavior. The aggressive controller needs to own that she has difficulty listening to no and accepting the limits of others. She needs to take responsibility for her need to control her friend. 5. What is needed? The unhappier one in the friendship, the compliant, needs to plug into a supportive group of people to help him with his boundary conflict. 6. How do they begin? In preparation for confronting his friend, the compliant needs to practice setting limits in his support group. The aggressive controller could really benefit from honest feedback from loving friends on how she runs over people and how she can learn to respect the limits of others. 7. How do they set boundaries? The compliant applies biblical principles to his friendship. He confronts his friend or her control and intimidation. He tells her that the next time she tries to control him, he will leave. He does not attempt to control her. Confrontation isn't an ultimatum meant to rob her of her choices. He sets limit to let her know that her control hurts him and wounds their friendship. Such limits protect the compliant from further hurt. The aggressive controller can become as angry or intimidating as she wants, but the compliant won't be around to get hurt. He will be out of the room, the house, or the friendship until it's safe to come back. The aggressive controller experiences the consequences of her actions. Not having a friend around may force her to miss the attachment, and she can begin to take responsibility for the control that ran her friend off. 8. Now what? At this point, if both friends are open, the two can renegotiate the relationship. They can set new ground rules such as, "I'll stop nagging you if you will stop being critical," and can build a new friendship. Conflict 3. Compliant versus manipulative controller. "Kathy, I'm in a real jam and you're the only one I can depend on to help me out. I can't get a babysitter for the kids and I have this church meeting. Kathy listened to the plight of her friend Sharon. It was a usual story. Sharon neglected to plan for events, to call ahead for sitters. She often called Kathy to help out in these self-induced emergencies. Kathy hated being stuck in this position. Sharon didn't do it on purpose and she needed her for a good cause. But Kathy still felt used and exploited. What was she to do? Many friendships get stuck in this interaction between compliant and manipulative controllers. Why do we call Sharon controlling? She's not consciously trying to manipulate her friend. However, no matter what her intentions good are, when she is in a jam, Sharon uses her friends. She takes them for granted, thinking that they shouldn't mind doing a friend a favor. Her friends go along saying, "Well, that's just Sharon." They stifle her, their resentment. Let's run this conflict through our boundary checklist. 1. What are the symptoms? The compliant Kathy feels resentment at the manipulative controller's Sharon's last minute request. Kathy feels as though her friendship is being taken for granted. She begins to avoid her friend. 2. What are the roots? Sharon's parents rescued her from every jam, from finishing term papers at 3 a.m. to lending her money when she was well into her 30s. She lived in a very forgiving universe where nice people would always help her out. She never had to face her own responsibility and lack of discipline and planning. As a child, Kathy didn't like her mother's hurt look when she said no. She grew up afraid of hurting others by setting boundaries. Kathy would do anything to avoid conflict with friends, especially with Sharon. 3. What is a boundary conflict? Sharon doesn't plan ahead and take responsibility for her schedule. When responsibilities get away from her, she calls out to the nearest compliant for help, and Kathy comes running. 4. Who needs to take ownership? Kathy, the motivated party in this conflict, sees how her never-ending yes contributes to Sharon's illusion that she doesn't ever have to plan ahead. Kathy needs to stop feeling like a victim and take responsibility for saying no. 5. What does she need? Kathy needs to connect with others who will support her as she looks at the boundary issues between her and her friend. 6. How does she begin? Kathy practices saying no with supportive friends. In a supportive atmosphere, she learns to disagree, to state her opinion, and to confront. They all pray for strength and guidance in this relationship. 7. How does she set boundaries? At their next lunch, Kathy tells Sharon about her feelings of being used and taken advantage of. She explains how she would like a more mutual relationship. Then, she lets her friend know that she won't be taking any more emergency babysitting jobs. Sharon, unaware of how she was hurting her friend, is genuinely sorry about the problem. She begins to take more responsibility for the schedule. After a few futile attempts to get Kathy to babysit at the last minute and having to miss a few important meetings, she starts planning for events a week or two ahead of time. 8. What happens next? The friendship grows and deepens. Over time, Kathy and Sharon laugh over the conflict that actually brought them closer. Okay, all, let's end up for today. In the coming sessions, we'll try to understand how the author talks about building the correct boundaries between you and your friends. Thank you for continuously listening to our recordings. Have a wonderful day.